Waheguru Ji ka Khalsa, Waheguru Ji ki Fateh. Sangat, we're here in New York City. So the Sevadars from California, the West Coast, are here with us as well. And we're going to be talking to Bhai Harmeet Singh, who is a parent of two sons. And they're going to tell us some tips and understanding of Sikh parenting and how their experience has been raising two young Singhs in California.
Raising two boys is a tough situation, especially in Cali and in the Western culture, and trying to keep them grounded in their Sikhi, it's a big challenge. But with Mother's kirpaa, it's so far it's been I think successful. One of the biggest things I think that our Sikh parents lack and are not doing is they're not spending time with their kids. 24 hours a day, they're thinking about money and work, which is important, right? But more for, okay, well, you know, my sister got a Mercedes-Benz and now I gotta work overtime and I gotta get one too to compete. And what that does, and now on the weekends you're working overtime, your kids are getting grown up, raised by the neighborhood with those Western ideas. And forgive you, example for me, you know, my parents came here in 77 and they used to work 7 days a week, 12 hours a day. So we lived in the hood, and you know, I was basically raised by Kali Masika because that's what my Sangat was. So what happens is when you get raised by people like that, there's no Sikhi involved, right? And then when you go to the Gurdwara on Sunday, you go there, eat langar matatik, and that's it. And so, and the parents are basically kind of burnt out to even talk to you about Sikhi. So Bhai Harman Singh talked about something in one of the classes a couple of years ago, which really stuck with me, was he said from 0 to 5, from 1 to 5, you know, pyar karo nana, pura rajke, don't be disciplining them too much and just kind of pyar, right? Teach them with that. Then from 6 to 15, you come down with the slotar. Not really, I mean, this is not with the slotar, you don't hit your kids. But meaning you're more rough, more tough, and more strict. You have to be more, because that's when you're molding them for society. And then after 16, it was 16 and afterwards, you become their best friend. So when Bhai Harman Singh told me that, that really hit me and how I looked at things. And I started kind of doing that with my boys. So one of my boys is 12 and one is 16. So the 16-year-old now, I don't really yell at him. I'll get mad, I just kind of explain, and it's been working really well. He's taking things in more, he's responding more, and not being as, you know, defensive, or you can call it. And my 12-year-old, he still gets yelled at, he's still more rough with them, but the good thing about it is he's seen Ishan grow, and he's actually changing a lot more faster than Ishan did, because he has someone to look up to and see an example. The one thing that's really important that I want all the parents to understand is you got to put your kids in some kind of boxing, martial arts when they're starting at 5, 6 years old. That is really important, really important, especially for the course. You know, they put the boys in, they don't put the girls in, and that's not good, because the girls actually need it more. They're more vulnerable in this society. Put your kids in a contact sport, let them get hit in the face a few times, so that when they're at school and they're wearing a dastaan or a patka and some kids mess with them, they're not afraid. You gotta kind of get that fear out of them. Because of that, both my boys, like, they've been through the ringer with me in an early age, training them. And then now, when they go to school, they stand up for what's right. They stand up for bullies. They're not scared. They're not scared to get hit. Biggest thing is when a kid freezes, is they've never been hit in the face. And there's just, when they do get hit, they just freeze, man. They don't know what to do because the body's in shock. So train your kids, pyar karo, discipline them. And the most important thing, I think, is that little sakis before they go to bed, it's really important. Start with Guru Nanak Dev Ji, Sakis, Bhai Mardana Ji. They're really nice and kind of funny too, right? Kids enjoy that. You know, Bhai Mardana Ji is always hungry and he's, you know, always complaining. It's kind of like, it's a beautiful relationship that they have. And so that was good with the boys. And now they both speak those Sakis to me, or if we're talking about something, they're related, because even though I told them 3 years ago, it stays in their back of their head and it always comes bragging later.
Your sons, they read Gurbani. Can you tell us how you got them into reading Gurbani?
3 years ago, during COVID, they learned from the good Prasad Vidyalaya and Humour Singh and Lepreet Singh, and then it made it fun for them. I told them, you know, what if they learn their akkars, I'll give them $20. And then it worked. And then the Maharani, I gave them $50, right? And then when they started learning Japji Sahib and so on, I said, every bunny you get gunt, I'll give you $100. So it actually worked out for them, and it kind of came, I mean, both ways. I mean, they actually took them, like, drive, and they hit those marks. And so they're close to $1,000 from each, which they wasted. But anyways, but the thing is, you might say, hey, lodge them down. But you know, sometimes you got to do what they got to do to get them going, right? And so that $1,000 was the best investment, you could say, because both of them are reading Shudbani now. They're doing Santhi every day with Parminder Singh. I learned from them. You know, I'm doing Bhat, and you know, kids pick up a little faster. I learn late too myself, and I'll doing Bhat, and my little one, Fateh Singh, dad, you said that wrong, and they're like, okay, cool. So it was rough in the beginning. You just got to stick at it. You got to be like, okay, if this is not done, you can't play games, you can't play with your friends. You got to be at a point that, like, this is priority. And in the beginning, it's rough, but now they're doing it themselves. They enjoy it. And you can't expect your kids to do all that if you're not doing anything, you know? So that's the main thing. A lot of parents are, sick, especially the good one, drop your kids off at the school, Gurmukhi sick, aap kadi ghat paati padna. So you gotta be example as a parent. Don't think that, you know, you have exception. Whatever you do, your kids are gonna do it. You're gonna drink sharab, your kids are gonna drink sharab. You're gonna beat your wife, the kids are gonna beat the wife. So it's whatever you show in your household is what's going to happen with the kids. So be a good example.
Guru Pyari Sadh Sangh Ji, just like Bhai Manpreet Singh Ji said, that the seed that you plant, the environment is what is going to decide what type of fruit and what type of nectar or poison that the child is going to bring and sprout into the world. Bhai Harsimranjit Singh Ji has spent a lot of time seeing Ishan Singh and Fateh Singh, the examples of Bhai Manpreet Singh Ji's two sons. I want you to, Bhai Sahib Ji, add in more, like, what type of things do you see that inspire them and create this environment around them that you see whenever you go over and spend time with them in raising them to Gursikhs in a world. And again, jehdi main gall keh reha, these young Singhs, they jaan bujh ke, they want to wear bana whenever they go to school. And one of the greatest things, Pastor, you can tell that story of when the Fateh Singh wanted to go to school and he wore bana.
Yeah, so I remember, I think a large inspiration for them is their parents. So, you know, their mother, their father, I think they do a tremendous job of just showing out exactly how a Khalsa lives their life, you know. Virji will never say this, but, you know, he never skips the Amrit Vela. You can tell your kids as much as you want, ki Amrit Vela utho, but if you don't get up yourself and do that bani, they're not going to want to do it either. So I remember, you know, Virji, he will wear a barna wherever he goes. And one day Fateh Singh Ji, which is Virji's younger son, said, you know, I want to start wearing barna to school. And, you know, Virji asked him, are you sure you want to do this? You know, because obviously there's an issue of bullying here and not fitting in and other self-crises such as these. And so I remember Fateh Singh Ji's response. He was like, yeah, I'm sure. He's like, okay, what are you going to say when people say, you know, why are you wearing this? He was like, you know, I'm going to tell them that this is a warrior's uniform under Guru Gobind Singh Ji. And he goes, okay, like, you know, what are you, why are you going to explain that, you know, why do you do it? And then he goes, I'm going to just show them that this is an expression of myself, an expression of who I am. And I'm allowed to be who I am whenever I want to. And, you know, hearing that response from him when he was 11 was just, it like brightens your day. It shows you that when a Khalsa is born and raised, that a Khalsa is going to become Pargat within that. And same thing goes with their Amrit Vela, same thing goes with their Sahaj Paat. You know, because their parents and the Sangat that's around them, you know, their countless amount of chachas and puas and everyone else in the Sangat, they look at this, you know, they say it takes a village. And I feel that
sometimes it takes a panth.
It takes a punt. Yeah. And sometimes it takes a punt. And so I think that one of the most beautiful things that I've seen about these boys growing up is that, you know, they're always looking to do the next thing. I remember one day Shan Singh woke up and just didn't ardas, Maharaj, bless me with shastars. And I see him doing shastar seva, you know, rubbing mitti, reta onto the kripana and cleaning them and, you know, properly taking care of them. And, you know, all of these things, they come from the heart. They come from hearing these sakhis. They come from being inspired, seeing art, reading Bani, wanting to learn how to do Shuddha Charan of Dasam Bani, wanting to, even when they're doing Santhya, their Santhya Ustads and the Gurprasad Dadyala are so kind to where, like, you know, if they're not really in the mood that day, they'll take it really easy, really light, but the habit gets formed that they have to show up. And if they don't show up, then Virji is always there to say, you never disrespect an Ustad.
Here's something that I'll add in there as well, because Maruti Kirpana, we get to meet a lot of Sangat, and sometimes you actually hear from kids that grew up in a Sikh household, they say, I watched my parents, I grew up in a Sikh household, but I don't know if it's really for me. And the main foundation level of that is because they feel that the Sikhi that they've been taught, not what truly what Sikhi is, because Sikhi, it's complete truth in it, right? But whatever their perception of them growing up, whatever Sikhi they received, they feel that it's not relevant in the real world that they live in. They feel it's not relevant at school because Dada might make you, you know, not look as clean as some of the clean shaven boys with the chin straps and that at high school. So the girls aren't looking at you. So therefore you feel inferior now because now you're feeling the Sikh values that you were taught are not relevant. And that relevancy is that they're gonna see from the parents. Are the parents sukhi? Are they peaceful truly? Are they just living Sikhi on the outside? Is it just for the relatives? Is it just for the sake that we are Punjabi and we are Sikh? So when you resonate that level of Sikhi and that Anand, your children will look at you and they'll say, my dad is in Anand, he's blissful, his life is so much better because he follows Guru Sahib's hukam, and I want to do the same. And when that relevancy and they live that lifestyle, that's why one of the biggest things, as soon as they turn become a teenager, they need to be your best friend. You need to bring them into the environment. Sometimes just through the parents is not enough. They need to go and look at those that are 3-4 years older than them, those that are 5 years older than them, not 50 years older than them, not 10 years older than them, just 3-4 years, because that is the inspiration gap. They want to become like their elder bajis and banjis. And what you place around the house is subconsciously giving them signals. If you have pictures of Baba Ajit Singh Ji kicking down the Mughals with arrows through their knees, bro, they're gonna want to grow up and want to become that. If they see Baba Deep Singh Ji with a khanda in their hand, they're gonna want to become that. If they see Mata Sahib Devan Ji sitting there, akhaan surtiyan parmatma de dhyan de vich likhe, they're gonna want to become that. If they see pictures of Sant Janel Singh Ji, Sant Gyani Guru Bachchan Singh Ji, Bhai Randhir Singh Ji, you know, when they see these sort of Gurmukhs and their photos, those become their inspirational images. Now, if they see Justin Bieber photos, Teletubbies, they see Shah Rukh Khan, they see Hrithik Roshan, they see whatever all these, you know, jengi mengis, whatever's out there. If they see them, they're going to become them. They're going to be inspired by them. What do you play on TV? Is Sikhi just a part-time Sunday gig for you? Or are you living it day and night? Are you living it inside and out? And sachi gal hai pyareo, if you live it, you will resonate that not only to your children. And ek hor main ek adhyatmik gal main add kar dema. Sometimes we have our own karma that we bring into this world. And those children that we gave birth to and we're trying to raise, sometimes it's just a play of karma. We gave them dukh sometimes in a previous life, they're giving us pain this time. The ardas that we must do, ki Maharaj, lekhe kate na chuti hai, khin khin pulan har bakshin har baksha hai, nanak paratar, ke sache pacha, please forgive my karma. Whatever karma I bring into my family and whoever I have sanjog with, these connections, whether it's my wife or my family, Maharaj, these children are not my children. Forget them, they're not your children. Give your children to Guru Sahib Ji. Do this ardas, ki Maharaj, give me the seva to raise these children in your hukam. As soon as you do that ardas, ki Maharaj, rip my negative karma away. Bless me with positive karma. Maharaj will do that. Maharaj will make your children their own. If you keep your anka that they're my kids, I want to raise them. I'm going to do it my way because I know best. And then Maharaj say, Tere karma anusar, this is what you have. This is what your karma has in store for you. But Maharaj, I don't have any good karma. Be humble in this way. Accept and say, Guru Saheb Ji, they are your children. And let me do seva of you raising your panth in this way by acting in this world as a parent, doing, fulfilling the role of a parent. And once I fulfill that role, Satya Pacha, I am along with the panth. They are your panth. Everything is yours.
One thing I do want to add is 99% of what my boys are today is because of my singing. That is the main thing. Jere karte bibi hai na, mata karte. All, everything falls on her because if she puts the effort in, she makes sure that, you know, whatever I want, she implies it. She makes sure the kids are doing it. And it's like, in my opinion, it's 99% all because of the bibi. So that's why it's really important, you know, for the BBN to be involved in these, because in the beginning they're with the mother, and whatever they learn from the mother, that's what they're going to become. And so luckily that Maharaj has blessed me with a beautiful wife that understands and has the same piyar of Guru Saab. And she's the one of the main reasons, she's the backbone of our family, and because of her, all of us three thrive.
It's true. The mother is what holds the entire family together, is going to create that environment. And Madi Kokh Deva Jiri Pagatiya, that is what we grew up in. Our bodies are created through that. Bibi Gurpreet Panji on our channel, she's created a course on pregnancy, so definitely check that out, that out as well, from somebody that has gone through that experience speaking about it.
Thank you, Sasangaji, for joining us on this episode of going through parenting, Sikh parenting,
in this kathakar.
So I hope you guys enjoyed seeing all the Sikhs who are doing much seva on the ground, in the Gurukars, at different places. So we hope to see you in the next one. Pul chuka dikhi maji, aao fateh bilaiye. Waheguru ji ka khalsa, Waheguru ji ki fateh.
If you enjoyed this video, please like, comment, share and subscribe. Please donate and help spread Guruji's message. Link is in the description below. Waheguru ji ka khalsa, Waheguru ji ki fateh.
Why would you want to live a mundane normal life when I can give you a beautiful life? Carry on doing what you're doing, but can you make each moment beautiful? Most people don't know that Guru Nanak went to jail. And what did he do when he was in jail? He was meditating. He said, okay, I'll make this a beautiful moment as well. Balance is a very important word. And it is very easy for us to feel overwhelmed. We've got so many commitments. We have family commitments, work commitments. We've got a study. We've got a social life. We have that Netflix series that we all need to binge watch because we haven't got around to seeing it yet. We've got so many things that we need to do. And then somebody comes along and says, but you haven't woken up early in the morning and you haven't done your prayers and you haven't done your meditation. And so what we begin to do is we begin to see it as another burden, another thing that needs to be done in our life. And what I love about Guru Nanak Dev Ji's technique, Guru Nanak gives you a wisdom that was designed for busy people in modern day lives. You see, spiritual wisdom before Guru Nanak Dev Ji was very much reserved for monks. So in order for you to have a spiritual life, you had to abandon your family responsibilities, your work, your job. You had to leave and go and sign up to a group somewhere sitting in the Himalayan mountains meditating away. You weren't allowed to wear designer clothes. You had to get rid of all of those and wear these religious garbs. Guru Nanak Dev Ji comes along, and when he goes and visits all of these various religious groups, they ask him, well, you're so spiritual. Why don't you leave your wife and family and why don't you come join us? Why don't you come and join our spiritual clan? And Guru Nanak gives a fantastic answer. He says, the whole world is burning right now and the people who can help are up here meditating on a mountain. You guys have the ability to help, but you're not helping the real people. I want to show the common working person who is married, who does have a job, who does have children, I want to show them how to do that spiritual connection while they're doing all those busy things. And so he comes up with a technique, which is that wherever you are, whatever you're doing, meditate at that moment. So you have a beautiful line from the Sukhmani Sahib, which says, Uthat, Baithat, Sovat. This is the technique of Gurbani. While you're sleeping, while you're awake, while you're having a conversation, have the mindset change so you don't need to stop anything that you're doing. This is the problem, that most of us have not been trained with this technique. So even now, all of you who are sitting here watching this screen right now, where is your mind? Can you feel a sense of centeredness? Can you feel the flavor in the air? Can you feel the beauty that's all around you right now? You don't have to go somewhere else. You don't have to stop what you're doing. You can realize that the very act of breathing becomes a meditation if you apply Guru Nanak's wisdom of Naam. Naam means right here, right now, there is a beauty to this moment. There is a beauty to the fact that I am breathing even though I have nothing to do with it. I'm not causing this breath to happen, it's happening. My eyes can see, that's Naam. My ears are listening, that's Naam. That is available to you right now. So this connection, this method that Guru Nanak Dev Ji has brought is so wonderful because right now, right here, it's available to you. So you don't have to go somewhere else. But I think for a lot of us, we almost don't want to get into this space. We're very comfortable with our life. In fact, what we want to say, can I not just have a prayer that I do for 5 minutes in the morning and then I get on with my normal life? But Guru Nanak is saying, why would you want to live a mundane, normal life when I can give you a beautiful life? Carry on doing what you're doing, but can you make each moment beautiful? Right now, when you're eating your food, can you make that a beautiful moment? And so this is such a wonderful methodology that Guru Nanak Dev Ji has offered to you, and he's trained you on a different way to get on with that busy life. Think about how busy Guru Nanak was. Think about all the things that the gurus managed to achieve. Not only were they writing thousands and thousands of verses teaching us how to do these things, Guru Nanak was building cities, creating communities. There were so many different things. At later points, the gurus even needed to fight battles. There were so many social injustices that the gurus had to stand up for. You can't say that Guru Nanak didn't have a busy life. So if your teacher has shown you how to have a busy life and a wonderful life, I mean, Guru Nanak, most people don't know, was even sent to prison. Most people don't know that Guru Nanak went to jail. And what did he do when he was in jail? He was meditating. He said, okay, I'll make this a beautiful moment as well. So this is the technique that the guru has lived and shown us that this is possible. Now the question is this something that you're interested in your life? Is this something that you want to take on onto your life? Do you want to make every moment beautiful in your life, regardless of what you're doing? If you're sitting at home watching Netflix, it can be beautiful. If you're out socializing with your friends, it can be beautiful. So this is something that's available to you. The real question is, do you want it? And that's where you have to start asking, am I interested in this? Does this sound appealing to me? Or do I just want to carry on with my daily life and then maybe just slot in a couple of minutes of meditation or prayers or nitname in the morning? That's up to you.
Hi, this is Larry Weaver. My topics of creativity, attitude, and motivation are crucial to success in any venture. Whether your focus is leadership, teamwork, customer service, sales, or just reducing stress. And the lessons are delivered with humor, so your attendees will retain the message. I look forward to helping you make your next event more fun and memorable. I think an important part of motivation is finding a definition of motivation that you like. I found this great definition that motivation is the energy and the ability required to maintain a positive attitude. The energy and the ability. Energy is taking care of yourself, eating right, exercising, doing things that make you feel good. But if you're going to do a new diet, it has to give you energy. The big culinary rage these days seems to be food trucks. Everybody's got a food truck now. I grew up in the country. We never had a food truck. The closest thing we had to a food truck is when the El Camino hit a possum. That's right, get yourself some white bread and you got a ditch witch. I appreciate y'all. My name is Larry Weaver. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
I'm not going to cut you in half, be perfectly fine. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to teach you how to levitate four people at your next halftime show. Fair enough? Has anyone done it? Oh, awesome. No one's done it. So here's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for four people who like to have fun, who like to get a little crazy, not afraid of the camera, and who want to have one of the best photographs of the entire convention. But a true disclaimer, all right? You know, it's like the roller coaster. If you got a bad back, bad legs, you know, pregnant or expect to become pregnant, it's probably not for you, okay? I need four people. Who are my four? Right there. There's one. There's two. You're pointing to him. Four people, four chairs. It works like this. You guys like to dance?
Love it.
Oh, good. I'm sure we've got a little bit of dance music for you. Something upbeat, something kind of fun. Let's do this. Help out. Over them. You guys do what I do. Four chairs. It works like this. Ready? You're right. I protected the skirt. Don't worry, Stephanie. Four people, three chairs. Who wants to see two?